Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
All right, so very happy to have Shayan Ovizgaran, who's visiting us from Stanford. And we all know Shayan pretty well, so I won't say much over here. He's going to be telling us about his work on the traveling salesman problem.
Thank you, Edu, and thanks for inviting me here. Today I'm going to talk about new approximation algorithms for traveling salesman problem. This may have happened to many of you. You go for a short visit to a new place. Maybe you go for a conference to Boston, Cambridge area. And perhaps in the second day afternoon, you get tired. So you choose a couple of places to visit. Maybe you choose MIT, Harvard, Harvard Square, Prudential Center, Newberry Street. And of course, you do not have unlimited amount of time, so you want to head back to the conference as soon as possible. So the question is how to visit, what is the fastest route to visit all these places? And maybe in this case, this is the fastest route. So this problem is known as the traveling salesman problem. Okay. TSV has a rich history. It has been of interest from the very beginning of the field of combinatorics and graph theory. Euler, who was one of the pioneers of the field of graph theory, studied Knight's tour in a chessboard. This was a question raised by one of his colleagues. And he proved that a knight can start from a cell in a chessboard and visit all of the cells exactly once. And here is such a tour. Later on, about 100 years later, Hamilton and Kirkman studied Hamiltonian paths and cycles in various classes of graphs. And the name Hamiltonian tour comes from their work. So TSV has always been a source of inspiration. Procter & Gamble ran a contest in 1962, and the challenge was to solve an instance of TSV with 33 cities. And they awarded the winner $10,000 at that time.
Wow.
And nowadays, you can even use your cell phone to solve an instance of TSV. There is a TSB iPhone app. Next time you go to a new city, you can just use your smartphone to find the shortest tour to visit the places you want to see. Also, Dimax is continuously running a TSB challenge. And the task is to find a near optimal solution for some hard instances of traveling salesman problem. TSB has always been one of the most important problems in the field of computing. Many of the evolutions in the field started with works on TSP. For example, TSP was one of the first problems proved to be NP-complete in the work of Karp in 1971. One of the first approximation algorithms was the work of Christofides on traveling salesman problem. One of the first average case analysis was the work of Karp on random instances of TSP. One of the first applications of linear integer programming techniques was the work of Danzig, Fulkerson, and Johnson on an instance of TSP. Also, TSP has been one of the first applications of many of the heuristic techniques, such as branch and bound technique or cutting plane method. Okay. So let me now tell you about TSP in theory and what we know about TSP in theory. The fastest known algorithm that we know for TSP that solves every instance of TSP to optimality runs in time c to the n, where n is the number of vertices, for some constant c greater than 1. Currently, it's about 1.66. And we believe that there will never be any efficient algorithm for this. And of course, p not equal to NP conjecture implies that there will never be an efficient algorithm. So what we do instead, we're going to try to design an efficient algorithm with a guaranteed near optimal solution.
I forgot, did you formally define TSP?
I'm going to define formally.
But And is the number of vertices, and you don't have any kind of metric assumption or something. It's just arbitrary distances, right?
You have a metric assumption, but yeah. So for a general version, you assume that you have a metric and you want to find the shortest tour that visit all these places. Or let me get to the definition. So instead, we try to study efficient algorithms with a guaranteed near optimal solution. And this is what we do in the field of approximation algorithms. So the approximation ratio of an algorithm is the worst case ratio of the solution computed by the algorithm to the of the cost of the solution computed by the algorithm to the cost of the optimum. Okay? For example, if you have a true approximation, this means that you have an efficient algorithm with a guarantee that its solution is always at most twice of the optimum. The holy grail in this field, in the field of approximation algorithm, is to design an approximation algorithm for TSP or your problem of interest with the smallest possible approximation ratio. Okay. I'm well aware of the pitfalls of approximation algorithms compared to heuristics, but let me here tell you about the advantages of this field. Okay. First of all, typically approximation algorithms introduce new techniques and new tools that can be later used by other algorithms or other heuristics. They provide better understanding of hard instances of our problem. For example, for TSP, still we do not have any good idea how a hard instance of TSP would look like. They also provide a unified metric for comparing different algorithms. Also, they are one of the most rigorous approach to attack an optimization problem, and they typically provide better understanding of the combinatorial structure of our problem. Okay? So now let me tell you about approximation algorithms for TSP. Christofides designed in 1976 designed a 1.5 approximation for TSP. And since then, for 35 years, researchers have tried to beat his algorithms. So many people have thought about it, but still no one has ever succeeded. So it remains a central, one of the major open problems in the field to design an approximation algorithm for TSP with a better approximation factor. Design an algorithm that can beat the 1.5 approximation of Christofides.
Is that complexity lower bound?
Yes. Currently, it's about 1.01. So here is the outline of the rest of the talk. First, I will talk about our contribution to TSP. Then I'll talk about our algorithm and a little bit of the analysis. And then I will focus on other aspects of my research. So let me start by talking about our contribution. We study an important special case of TSP, okay, called graphic TSP. Okay. Suppose we are given an unweighted graph. We want to find the shortest tour that visits every vertex of this graph at least once. So consider this graph. I'm going to use it as a runner throughout my talk. If we start from that point, here is a tour that visits each vertex at least once. So up to this point, we have visited every vertex exactly once. Now we have to get back to the starting point. So we need to take three additional steps. And now we get a TSP tour. Okay? The cost of this solution is the number of its edges. And the point is, if we allow this graph to be weighted, this was exactly the general version of TSP. So the general version of TSP is when our graph is weighted, and we want to find a tour that visits each vertex at least once.
You're allowing more than one visit per vertex?
It's the same. You can, if you assume you have a metric, then visiting each vertex exactly once is if It's the same as if you don't assume anything on the metric, instead say, you say, I want to see each vertex at least once.
Clarify, the issue with TSP is not about weights with many bits, right? You can assume the weights are...
No, it's about the weights.
It's about the weights,
right,
that have many bits?
It's not about the weight precision.
It's not about, the problem is just as hard, or even if the weights are just, say, integers between 1 and n to the 10 or something, or is it...
1 and 100, I think, is hard enough for us.
Yeah.
1 and 2.
And by the way, the picture has a planar graph, but that's just for the picture.
Yeah, that's just for the picture, right?
So it's an arbitrary graph, just unweighted as opposed to weighted. That's the only difference.
Exactly. If it is weighted, then it's the general version. If it's unweighted, that's what we're going to do. And the importance of this is that it includes all of the theoretical hard instances of TSP, all of the instances you get from the NP hardness results from the PCP results. Okay.
So you know that also for this you can't get better than 1.01.
Yes. Yeah, for this you cannot, yeah. So this is, for example, strictly harder than the Euclidean TSP. Okay. So in 1976, Christofides designed his 1.5 approximation. At that time, Apple released the first generation of their first generations of Apple computers. Now, during these years, computers get faster and faster, but still there was no improvement to TSP. Until with the introduction of MacBook Air, we finally managed to break Christofides. And design a 1.5 minus epsilon approximation for graphic TSP. Okay.
You should prepare the talk for the right company.
Also coincides with Microsoft Surface launch.
Okay, let's go on.
So in a joint work with Saberi and Singh, we show that there is a 1.5 minus epsilon approximation for graphic TSP. And here, epsilon is a constant greater than 0. In addition to that, we develop a new method called rounding by sampling method that I'm going to talk about it later in the talk. Furthermore, we prove new graph theoretical results on a structure of near minimum cuts, building on the works of Benksur, Karger, and Gomans. We also prove new properties of random spanning trees. I'm going to tell you about both of these last two also later in the talk. Okay.
What is epsilon?
Epsilon is about 10 to the minus 20 or something.
So can you distinguish that on the MacBook Air?
That's a good question. Okay, so
you get a commission from all the savings from the traveling salesperson.
Okay. Shortly after our result, people started to work on this problem. And it was like every 4 months, a new paper came out with a better approximation factor. And after a year or so, the factor is improved to about 1.4. And okay, time will show us when this will stop. So in the next 10 minutes, I'm going to talk about our algorithm. And in this part, I'm going to tell you the rounding by sampling method. Okay. Let me first give you a very high-level overview of the algorithm. Given a TSP instance, first we consider a continuous relaxation of the problem. This is also known as a linear programming relaxation. We use one of the off-the-shelf LP solvers to solve that and get an optimal fractional solution. So this part can be done automatically. Now the second step is called the rounding step, where we want to round the fractional solution into a near optimal integral solution. Okay. And this is the heart of the proof. Okay. So let me show you how we do this rounding step by comparing our algorithm to the Christofides algorithm. Okay? Let me first tell you what Christofides does and then compare it with ours. He first considers a minimum spanning tree on the he first chooses a minimum spanning tree of the graph, and then he adds a minimum matching, minimum cost matching on the odd degree vertices of the tree. It turns out that the union of the tree and the matching would give you a TSP tool. And furthermore, the cost of this tool is at most 1.5, because the cost of the tree is at most optimum, and the cost of the matching is at most half of the optimum. Okay. Now let me tell you what we do. The main difference is in the selection of a spanning tree. Instead of choosing a minimum spanning tree, we choose a random spanning tree based on the solution of LP relaxation. And then we add the minimum cost matching on the odd degree vertices of the tree. Okay? Now, in this particular example, Christofides gives exactly 1.5 approximation, whereas our algorithm in this example gives about 5/4 approximation.
And do you always save in one part of the argument? For example, is you?
Yeah, we save in the second part. In the first part, we pay opt. I'm going to tell you more later.
And the improvements from epsilon to 1.4 or whatever, is it using the same algorithm?
No, they're different.
Same ideas?
No. So all of those three papers, so the main difference is here we start from a spanning tree, then we add the edges. In those papers, they may also delete some edges. So the algorithm is kind of completely different.
Here, if you're only allowed to visit each vertex once, you have a problem, right? How do you convert this to that?
So once you have a tool that visits each vertex exactly once, you can take an Eulerian tool of that and then shortcut once you visit.
If you have a Euclidean metric.
No, you don't need to assume you have Euclidean metric. Give me any graph. I find a TSP tool that visits each vertex.
I have a metric on the graph, on the vertices.
Yeah,
you have to have a metric.
I mean, okay, it depends how you define the problem. If you let the problem to be find a tool that visits each vertex at least once, then you can have arbitrary graph and then turn it to a tool that visits each vertex exactly once. Otherwise, you can assume you have a metric and then you can ask for a tool that visits each vertex exactly once. And these two are...
But it's not the more general problem of
They're exactly the same. Because
I'll take it offline.
Okay.
No, you're not solving the general TSP problem. You always have to assume it's a metric.
Right.
No,
I think the general TSP problem is the one that he defined, and people noticed that on a metric, you could insist that you visit every vertex only once, and that became part of the mathematical definition, but there's no motivation for the mathematical definition.
Right. I think we should let him go.
Exactly.
Right. I think we should let him go with the problem as he stated it. And yeah.
And
offline, we can talk about the difference.
Okay. I'm going to tell you how we're going to do the first step in more detail. Okay, let me first tell you how an optimal fractional solution of LP relaxation of TSP look like. Okay, it has two properties. The first one is that every vertex has fractional degree 2, exactly 2. This means that the sum of the fraction of edges adjacent to each vertex is exactly 2. And the second one is that every cut has at least a fraction 2 of edges, meaning that the sum of the fraction of edges in each cut is at least 2. Okay? Let me show this to you on this picture, on our instance. So here, say the solid edges have fraction 1, and the dashed edges have fraction 1/2. Okay? Then if you look at each vertex, it has 2 dashed edges and 1 solid edge, so its fractional degree is 2. Now if you look at, for example, this cut, it has 4 dashed edges, so it has fraction 2 of edges.
So now I'm confused. If you could have optimal things where they visit every vertex more than, they need to visit some vertices more than once, right?
Yes. But you can ask the optimum to visit each vertex exactly once.
You can ask the optimum to visit each vertex exactly once?
Yeah, once you take the metric.
Once you add in the edges that are impeded by
you add the edges that are not, and then you...
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So that explains...
But for the algorithm, we can output it and then convert them. Or for example, this cut has value 3 because it has 2 solid edges and 2 dashed edges. Okay, so each cut has value at least 2.
Oh, at least 2. Okay.
Now let me tell you how we can turn this solution.
So fraction means sort of half integer.
No, it means anything. He's just giving an example.
Yeah, my example has half, but it could be very small.
It sums up to.
Right.
The fraction of weight sum up to at least 2 in the cut.
Right. And that's his definition of his fraction.
Yes.
I mean, of his fractional solution.
But it actually should be a fraction and not sort of pi and 1 minus pi, pi over 2 and 1 minus pi over 2. So
it'll be rational.
It could
be rational.
Yeah, it would be rational.
Sure.
The solution that that LP solver would give you would be a rational.
Rational, right. That's...
Okay. So let me now tell you how we can round this fractional solution into an integral solution. Traditionally, we would have used the independent randomized rounding method. So this is a method developed in the beautiful work of Raghavan and Thompson. And the idea is to round each edge independently. Okay. So, for example, in our example, since the solid edges have fraction 1, we're going to round each of them without any, we're going to round each of them to 1. There is no randomness, so the solid edges will be selected. Now, the dashed edges, each of them has fraction 1 half, so we're going to round them independently with probability 1 half. So maybe these edges are selected. Okay. Now, the advantage of this method is that it preserves quantitative properties. This is because the probability of choosing each edge is equal to its fraction. And a disadvantage is that it loses structural properties, meaning that particularly the rounded solution will not be connected with high probability. Okay? And in fact, because of this, this method cannot even give you 1.5 approximation. Okay? So what are we going to do? What can we do instead? Instead, we use the rounding by sampling method. Now, turns out that we can write the LP solution as a fractional spanning tree, as a point inside the spanning tree polytope. Okay? Now, any point inside the spanning tree polytope can be written as a convex combination of the extreme points. Okay? In this case, they're going to be spanning trees. So we write our point as a convex combination of spanning trees. Now, this defines a distribution on a spanning tree. So we're going to choose a tree from that distribution. Now, the advantage of this method is that it again preserves quantitative properties because the probability of choosing each edge is equal to its fraction. Therefore, the expected cost of the tree that we choose is equal to the cost of the LP and is less than the optimum.
These two conditions that you said before are equivalent to being in the spanning tree polytope? That this degree is to,
the
cuts is at least...
It's not equivalent, but it implies.
It implies. Okay.
Do you have exponentially many spanning trees?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you may have exponential. Yeah, you can have exponentially many spanning trees. But you can write any point inside the polytope as a convex combination of only polynomial of them, only n squared of them.
These are really spanning like tree plus one edges, or this is not literally a convex combination of spanning trees since the total degree is different.
For here you need to do rescale your LP solution. Yeah, we're gonna rescale it by 1 minus 1/n. Yeah. Okay. But unfortunately, this is not sufficient for us. And this is not going to give you better than Christofides. It just gives you 1.5 approximation. So we need one more idea. Now, if you have a point inside a spanning tree polytope, there are many ways to to write it as a convex combination of extreme points. So the question is, what is the right convex combination? What is the right distribution? Okay. And our idea is to avoid imposing any artificial structure, any additional structure. You want to keep the combinatorial structure intact while maximizing the randomness. That's why we're going to write our LP solution as a distribution of spanning trees with maximum entropy. Okay. Now, if I ask you what is the distribution of spanning trees with maximum entropy, obviously you say it is a uniform distribution. But here, I don't just want a distribution with maximum entropy. I want a distribution for which the probability of each edge is equal to its fraction while maximizing the entropy. Okay. So we prove that this distribution, although it is not uniform, it is a weighted uniform distribution. We call it lambda uniform, meaning that we can assign weights lambda to the edges such that the probability of each edge is equal to the product of the weight of its edges. And these weights can be computed efficiently using max entropy convex program. This theorem is from an earlier work of mine with Asadpour, Gomans, Sabari, and Madri. Okay. So let me, to understand this, let me give you an example. Okay. Let's see how this would look like on our beloved example. So remember that the LP values was 1 on the solid edges and 1/2 on the dashed edges. Now it turns out we have to assign the lambda values as follows. We're going to assign lambda value of infinity to the solid edges and 1 to the dashed edges. Okay.
So you put the solid edges in there for sure. And
yeah. Now let me show you how a random spanning tree from this lambda uniform distribution look like. First of all, remember that we can sample a random spanning tree using matrix tree theorem or by running random walk. So sampling is fine. Now let's see how the sample would look like. So first of all, as Jennifer said, a spanning tree that have more number of solid edges would have much larger probability because solid edges have such a large weight. Okay, so all of the solid edges will be selected. So they're going to have probability 1. Now let's see what happens to the dashed edges. In particular, let's see these two dashed edges. Okay. There are 4 possibilities. Either 2 of them are selected, none of them are selected, the top one or the bottom one is selected. Okay. Now if 2 of them is selected, this makes a cycle. Okay. So this cannot happen. If none of them is selected, then we get a disconnected graph. So this cannot happen either. So it remains the last two.
Because it had to be a tree.
Yeah, but it can happen only once. Right. Let's forget about that. So it remains the last two. And because the top edge and bottom edge both have lambda value of 1, the last two cases, one of them, they're going to happen with equal probability. The probability 1 have the top one, and the probability 1 have the bottom one. So from these two edges, one of them will be selected at random. So this means that the probability of top edge and bottom edge would be 1/2. So one of them will be selected. Then from the next pair, one of them will be selected, and so on and so forth. So you get a random span. Okay, for each pair of edges, this would happen. So here is our final algorithm, our rounding by sampling algorithm for TSP. First, we compute an optimal solution of the LP relaxation. Then we write the LP solution as a lambda uniform distribution of spanning trees. Then we sample a tree from that distribution using matrix tree theorem. And then we add a minimum cost matching on the odd degree vertices of the tree.
Probabilistic guarantee?
So it gives a randomized algorithm, and we can show that in expectation, its cost is 1.5 minus epsilon times the optimum.
The worst case could be much worse.
Yeah, we don't have any bound on worst. It's expectation.
I mean, you have the same bound as Christofides, no, because it's always a spanning tree.
No, but the expected cost of the random the tree that we choose is equal to optimum. In the worst case, it could be much larger.
Worst case, over the randomness.
Because it's not a minimum spanning.
Yeah, right. It's not a minimum spanning. It's a random spanning.
Is it even with high probability a result?
How do you get tightness? I don't see
how. I mean, yeah, because you know, the cost isn't going to be less than one. And if the expectation is, you know, 1.5 minus epsilon, then it can't be too bad, right?
Of course, it can't be too bad, but
expectation. Like,
so if you want 1.5 minus epsilon over 2, then you just sort of sample many times to define one.
Of course, you can sample many times, but if you sample once, then I should do the calculation. But yeah, of course, you can sample many times, and then you would get a high probability.
Get it tighter, yeah, sure.
Okay. So,
where do you think? What falls apart when you try to do this on a weighted graph?
Exactly. I'm gonna tell you this now. Okay. So let me tell you a little bit of the analysis. Unfortunately, I will not have time to give you the full proof, so I'll give you the main ideas and main components. So we conjecture that this algorithm gives 1.5 minus epsilon approximation for general TSP without this graphic assumption. And in fact, we don't have any example with approximation ratio worse than 4/3. But okay, we cannot prove this. So we're going to prove a weaker statement that this idea.
So there's this famous Hell-Carp conjecture which says that this
thing
is going to be 4/3. The difference between that and yours is that in your case, you're also fixing the full algorithm.
Hell-Carp just says the integrality gap is 4/3.
This is kind of the rounding algorithm that might prove potentially that conjecture.
Yeah. But it cannot do better than that because the integrality gap of the LP relaxation is 4/3. So for sure, it's not going to do better. Okay. So we prove that this method gives a 1.5 minus epsilon approximation for graphic TSP.
So by the way, it might be reasonable to believe the more ambitious conjecture that it gives a 4/3 approximation for all TSPs?
Yeah. So let me tell you about the proof. First of all, remember that by the rounding by sampling method, the expected cost of the spanning tree is equal to the cost of the LP. So once we choose a random spanning tree, we pay opt in the first. Now, we have to show that the expected cost of the matching on the odd degree vertices of T of the tree is less than half of that. And this is the heart of the proof. And in fact, the difficulty is that here we have to use the fact that the tree is from a maximum entropy or a lambda uniform distribution. If you have arbitrary distribution, this would not be true necessarily. So here are the main components of the proof. Our proof builds on structure of near minimum cuts of the graph, as well as properties of random spanning trees. Okay? So in both of these, people have worked on both of these directions for many years, and there were quite a set of nice results, but still this wasn't enough for our purpose. So we had to prove new things. We prove results on placements of edges in near min cuts of a graph, as well as new properties of random spanning trees. We call it locally Hamiltonian properties. I'm going to describe. So I'm going to describe both of these components in two slides next. And then putting these components together, we managed to bound the cost of the matching. So let me tell you about each of these two components in one slide. So let me first start by new properties of near minimum cuts of the graph. So we prove the following statement. If almost all edges are in large, more than a constant number of near-min cuts, then the fractional solution is nearly integral. Okay? By a near mean cut, I mean a cut with value very close to 2. Say 2 plus epsilon. Okay? This is a purely graph theoretic statement. It has nothing to do with the randomness in the algorithm. So to understand it, let's think about the converse. If you have an integral...
Here we're talking of the graph, the weighted graph derived by the fractional solution from the LP, or...
Yeah.
What do you mean by nearly integral?
Almost all edges have value very close to 1. A value 1 minus epsilon. Almost n times 1 minus epsilon fraction of edges have value 1 minus epsilon. Okay. So let's think about the converse. If you have an integral solution of TSP, then it's obviously a Hamiltonian cycle. Then in an integral solution, every edge is an n minus 1 min cut. Okay, here you see an example. So our statement says that an integral solution is an extreme example. Now, the proof of this would have been much easier if you want to show this only for minimum cuts of a graph. For near minimum cuts, we had to extend the polygon representation of near minimum cuts, building on the works of Benk, Zur, and Gomans. We prove new properties of the polygon representations that can be of independent interest. Okay. Let me now tell you about the other component. If you choose a random spanning tree, you don't expect it to be a Hamiltonian path. Right? But here what we show is that although it's not a Hamiltonian path, if you look at it locally, you're going to find Hamiltonian path with some constant probability. Okay. We call this property locally Hamiltonian property.
What's it locally?
In a constant size subgraph, in a small subgraph.
So you fix a constant, you randomly choose one of the vertices in the tree, and you say with high likelihood you're not near branching.
No. I choose a particular subgraph of the whole graph. Let's say a constant size subgraph. Let's say a single vertex. And I want to say...
It has to be a local neighborhood, right?
Yeah.
Like you
local neighborhood based on the LP
ball,
solution.
A constant size ball around some vertex, and then inside it is...
Yeah, nice. But not necessarily all balls. I mean, it's a bit more technical, but yeah, the whole idea is something like this. So let me tell you how can we prove something like this, and you see... what's going on. So let's start with a single vertex. Okay? Let's say I want to say if I have a single vertex, it's going to have degree 2 with some constant probability. Okay? How can we prove something like this? Okay? First, remember that the expected degree of this vertex V is equal to its fractional degree in the LP solution. This is by the rounding by sampling method. So the expected degree of V is 2. Now, on the other hand, since we choose our spanning tree from a max entropy distribution, lambda uniform distribution, there is negative correlation between the edges. So we can apply Chernoff types of bound and say the degree of V is concentrated around its expectation. So
you would have already lost this if you had been not doing the... If you had just been doing like the standard Raghavan rounding, it would have already been gone. Yeah. Okay.
If you don't choose from a random spanning tree, you would have lost it.
Right.
From a
uniform spanning tree.
So you're applying Chernoff like bounds, but your variables are just each.
Or just edges. Edges. Yeah.
The edges coming out
just
of this one vertex.
Yes.
You don't have a large number of those.
Yes. But you don't need to have large number of those. You just want to apply a chain of bound on the expectation.
Okay.
The multiplicative chain of bound, not the additive one.
Uh-huh. It doesn't matter how many, but the degree of the expectation is small. I see. Okay.
So the degree of this vertex would be two with constant probability. Now let's see how we can talk about two vertices. Okay, so one vertex was easy. Say we have two vertices, V and U, and you want to say there is a constant probability that they both have degree 2. Okay? Sounds an innocent question. Like, you might think there is an elementary proof of this. And in fact, this is mainly because we know a lot about random spanning trees. We can, for example, write closed form expression for having multiple edges in a random spanning tree. But still, we don't know any elementary proof of this. And I would be very happy if I can find elementary proof of this. So while we were thinking about this, we found out about a line of research in probability theory on measures with negative dependence. In 2000s, Robin Pimentel wrote a very nice survey and asked a lot of questions and put a lot of open problems on measures with negative dependence property. And you know, for 10 years or so, researchers have thought about it. And very recently, Borsia, Brandon, and Liggett come up with...
People in the probability community really cared about this because of the Keston-Vandenberg inequality. So they started studying all these things. Yeah.
So these guys come up with a very nice paper on stronger Rayleigh measures. Okay? Let me not define these measures here. Here you can just see the definition. But the point is, these measures generalize uniform spanning tree measures. And they satisfy strongest form of negative dependence properties. So we could simply generalize our uniform spanning tree measures to these measures and work with them instead. This helped us to address conditional and joint distribution. And therefore, we could use these measures to, you know, talk about the probability of having two edges having degree 2.
So uniform spanning trees corresponds to lambda sub e's being 1?
But these measures, I mean, uniform and lambda uniform are not different, because if you have a lambda uniform, you can put many copies of that edge, and then this becomes a uniform distribution. So there, almost everything proved for uniform works for lambda uniform as well. So let me conclude this part of the talk. TSP is an old problem. Many people have thought about it and, you know, used a lot of ideas to attack it. We study TSP from a new point of view. We applied a new algorithm, a new technique called rounding by sampling method. And this method has been used for many other problems that I'm going to describe next. Our proof builds on recent developments in probability theory on measures with negative dependence property. We also characterize and prove new properties of near minimum cuts of a graph. So it still remains an open problem to design a 1.5 minus epsilon approximation for TSP. And here, our algorithm can serve as a candidate.
And so specifically, what goes wrong with your proof?
So currently what
so it's displacement of edges part, or is it does it have to flip both parts of your paper?
No, so currently the very high level idea is that we can say from the edges of the graph, from constant fraction of the edges of the graph, we can take advantage in the rounding step. So instead of, say, paying half of their cost, we pay 1/2 minus epsilon of their cost. So this implies that if the instance of TSP is unweighted, or if the weight of the edges is within constant factor of each other, which is the more general version, we can beat Christofides. But if you have weight edges with very large weight compared to others, it could be that our advantage are from the edges with a small weight. So although we gain from them, our gain is not sufficient to beat the Christofides.
So you lose, you can get a 1.5 minus something like epsilon over u, where u is like the ratio of the between weights or something.
Yeah. And the other TSP result doesn't have this. Like, those improvement on us doesn't. They're just for the unweighted version. So Now let me tell you about other applications of the rounding by sampling method. In the next 4 minutes, I'm going to tell you about that. First, let me tell you about applications of this method in practice. I implemented our algorithm, and I tested it on some hard instances of TSP from public TSP library. I compared our performance with Christofides and one of the best heuristics on TSP called Lynn-Kernighan heuristic. And here are the results. Each column represents one test case of the TSP leap, and the numbers in each column are the number of vertices in that instance. I compared the solution of these algorithms with the optimal solution of the LP relaxation. Now, as you can see, we do quite better than Christofides, but still we cannot beat the heuristics. But one of the reasons for that could be the fact that these heuristics typically implement the best of many ideas, but here we just have one idea.
For all you know, those instances may be Euclidean or something.
These are not Euclidean.
Right.
But yeah, I think they are mostly random instances of TSP. There isn't any documentation how they are generated.
I guess they're too big. There are instances where you actually know what is the. They don't know what the optimal thing there is, right?
Yeah, if the instance is so large, yeah, they don't know what is the optimal. Okay. So it's better to compare it with the LP relaxation.
In these instances, they do know the optimal.
Yeah, they do know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think for this ones they do know. Yeah. I'm not sure for the last one, but for the first two.
But they know the optimum, and is the optimum? What's the value of the optimum?
One.
Yeah.
One?
No, the optimum is certainly more than the LP relaxation.
The optimum, one is the value of the LP.
No, the optimum could be slightly better, but this shows the LP. And because of the last row, the optimum is not very different from the LP, right? Because you can get.
Did you run your algorithm just once, or did you do it several times and take the minimum?
I take a couple of spanning trees and take the best of them. I mean, yeah. Once you have the lambda uniform distribution, you can sample many spanning trees and take the best of them. So we also use this method to attack an important generalization of TSP called asymmetric TSP. This is where the distances are not necessarily symmetric. Say you want to solve TSP in a city with one-way streets. Okay. For this problem, Fries, Diabetti, and Maffioli designed a log-n approximation in 1982. And after so many years, although many people have worked on this, only the constant in front of the log n improved, and log n remained as a barrier. In a joint work with Asadpour, Gomans, Madri, and Saberi, we proved that almost the same algorithm that I described here gives a log n over log n approximation for asymmetric TSP, thus breaking the log n barrier. In fact, this work was previous to the TSP work. Nowadays, this method has become as a new tool in algorithm design. Like, many people have used it. In a joint work with Manshadi and Saberi, we use this method to attack online stochastic matching problem. Also, in a joint work with Lakinakit and Singh, we use it to attack minimum strongly connected subgraph problem. Also, other people have started to use this method. Ann Kleinberg and Shemois, in a very nice paper, use this method to give an improved approximation algorithm for TSP path problem. I've worked on approximability of various classes of problems. And unfortunately, I can just give one talk, so I would not be able to tell you about all of this. So let me, in the rest of the time, very briefly tell you about spectral algorithms. Okay. So spectral algorithms use graph eigenvalues and eigenvectors to solve an optimization problem. These algorithms are widely used in practice for data clustering and graph partitioning. This is mainly because because of the quality of their solution as well as their running time. This is a general framework for a spectral clustering algorithm that you may see. First, you embed the graph in a high-dimensional space using the first k eigenvectors. You look at the first k eigenvectors, this would give you a k by n matrix. Now, you use each column as a coordinate of the corresponding vertex. This gives you an embedding of a graph in a high-dimensional space. Then you use one of the heuristics, for example, k-means algorithm, to cluster the points. Okay. Now let me tell you what we know about these algorithms in theory. Most of the analysis in theory on spectral algorithms use the first two eigenvalues. Here are a few examples of this. For example, the graph two partitioning, the Cheeger inequality, use only the first two eigenvalues. The optimal tree coloring of random graphs result by Alon and Cahill, Plantes clique problem, approximate max cut result, Trefison. So most of the analysis use only the first two eigenvalues. Now, let me tell you what we've done in this direction. We analyze a spectral algorithm from the point of view of higher eigenvalues. As I'm going to show you here, this implied, using this, we could improve many approximation algorithms and prove new results. So our first result in this direction was a higher order Cheeger inequality. This was a joint work with Lee and Trefison. We show that a graph has an ideal k-partitioning if and only if the kth eigenvalue of the normalized Laplacian matrix is very close to zero. Okay. Our proof provides the first rigorous justification for a spectral clustering algorithm that I just mentioned.
So the first k eigenvalues will all be close to zero in this case?
Yeah, because lambda k is the k point.
You're assuming that somehow you have access to all the eigenvalues of the graph?
Yeah, you can compute the eigenvalues of the graph this way, numerical algorithm. Perfect. So in a joint work with Kwok, Lee, Lau, and Trefison, you managed to improve the Cheeger inequality. Using higher eigenvalues of the graph. So if you know the Cheeger inequality, just let me briefly tell you that in the Cheeger inequality, you prove the expansion of the graph is at most a square root of lambda 2. Here we prove that it is at most order of k times lambda 2 over root lambda k. Yeah, I can write it here. So we improve root lambda 2 to so for example, if you put lambda 3, you see the improvement because lambda k is greater than lambda 2. Lambda 3 is greater than lambda 2, and so on. So this, for example, shows that if you have a graph where lambda k is very close to 0, lambda k is very close to 1, Cheeger inequality would give you constant factor approximation to sparse stuff. In fact, the spectral partitioning algorithm would give you that. In a joint work with Trefison, we managed to improve and to prove a new clustering algorithm with almost the same guarantee as the spectral partitioning algorithm, the one that just used the second eigenvector, but with the advantage that this new algorithm runs in time sublinear time, in time proportional to the size of the cluster. No, this one uses the random ones.
So it's just proportional to the size of the cluster or the number of clusters?
No, say you have just one cluster and you want to find it. You don't have to see all the graph. You just need to spend time proportional to the size of this cluster and get the same quality as of the spectral partitioning that just uses the second eigenvector. Yeah, if the cluster is much smaller, you do much less work. Also, in a joint work with Leon's, we prove universal bound on graph eigenvalues. For example, here we show
for all graphs.
We show, for example, if you have a if you have a connected deregular graph, then lambda k is at least k squared over n squared. For example, this shows for a cycle, cycle is the, everything, every of these inequalities type. Or if you have a general, if the graph is not regular, this becomes k cubed over n cubed. So there are a lot of results for, even for infinite graph, you have results for vertex transitive graph. So we use these results to better understanding random walks, bounding links in time, return probabilities. We also use them to design a spectral algorithm for approximate counting spanning trees. Also in a joint work with Trevisan,
So there are these bounds on the, if you have a power law graph that proves sort of power laws on the eigenvectors. Can you get those from your bounds?
So any graph would satisfy this, any connected graph.
I know, but the question is, so you get stronger bounds on the eigenvalues if you assume the graph is a power law graph.
Right.
Those are some work to prove. So the question is whether they are corollary to your general bounds.
Because he said these are saturating for a cycle, which is really.
If you haven't studied power law graphs in particular, but I can try it.
I mean, there are a lot of interesting questions sort of left open about spread of infections and so on power law graphs.
I see.
And I wonder whether your general bound.
as it is, probably will not help you because.
Right, because it would apply to anything. It would apply to a cycle.
But,
that it doesn't spread slower than the cycle or something.
Right. Because it's a universal.
Yeah. But typically, once you assume more about the graph, we can prove more things. So, for example, we also prove some bounds on graphs based on their volume growth. So I should think about power law graphs in particular, but if you assume more, if you know more about the graph, you can prove more about those particular classes of graphs. Also, in a joint work with Trevisan, we use higher eigenvalues of a graph to prove a new regularity lemma. And then we use that to design approximation algorithms for low threshold rank graphs. These are the graphs where the number of small eigenvalues of normalized Laplacian is not too large. The kth eigenvalue is close to 1. What?
So are these mouse graphs?
No, think of it as generalization of expander graphs.
Yeah.
Well, there are 3 regular expanders, so.
No, right, but also the complete graph could be, an expander or even a complete graph has a threshold rank 2 or something.
2.
And,
these
are kind of quasi
expanders. So it's really expander. It's generalizations of expanders.
Okay, so let me conclude. As a theoretician, I usually think how my research can impact practical applications. How can I be useful? And I try to have this in mind when I choose my direction of research. Here are 2 ways that I think a theoretician can be useful. The first one is to design new tools and new techniques that can be used, in other algorithms and other heuristics. And a second one is to prove theoretical justification for heuristics that people use in practice, but they don't have any idea why they're going to work. Our rounding by sampling method has become a new tool in the field of algorithms. Many people have used it. Also, we developed a new tool called spectral embedding to analyze the spectral algorithms. I didn't get time to talk about it here. But we have used it to analyze many spectral algorithms. Also, our proof on the traveling Salesman problem bounds the integrality gap of LP. This means that it shows that the solution of the LP can be used as a good certificate of the value of the optimum solution. So heuristic can use that. We also prove theoretical justification for the spectral clustering algorithm. So let me stop here. Thanks for listening.